Let me invite you to take out your message guide, if you would, and invite you to follow along as we open God's Word together. And we are starting a new series that coordinates with our theme for the year, and we're calling it 9 to 5. 9 to 5. You know, our culture has a lot to say about work, because so much of our time is spent at work. So much of our life is spent at work over the course of it. And so we're going to just take a little like 30 or 45 second dive into some culture as we begin each of these messages. And so just give a listen to what culture thinks here. Mark?
Stumble to the kitchen, pour myself a cup of ambition, and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets, the traffic starts jumping with folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living. Barely get to.
How many of you know that song? Yeah, everybody knows that song. 9 to 5, Dolly Parton. What a way to make a living, right? What a way to live. Just thinking that all I have to live for, and all that my life is about, is just 9 to 5. But God has so much more for us than just 9 to 5. But His desire is for us to magnify Him, and for us to glorify Him, and for us to allow people to see Him as we navigate our 9 to 5. And that really, again, ties in with our theme for the year, which is the idea of being magnified. The psalmist in Psalm 40, verse 16, talks about the work of God in his life and how God has just been so incredible, and God has met him, and how God has helped him in the journey. And he says at the end, he says, in all of these things, the Lord be magnified. The Lord be magnified. So as we go through the next 50 weeks of this year, we're going to be focusing on the idea of how we can magnify Christ, how we can focus in on Christ, how we can make Him bigger through our lives in a variety of different ways. Ultimately, though, in every way, may it be that people see Christ in us and in every place. So we're going to start with just this brief series this morning on allowing Christ to be seen in our employment, in our workplace. And for a lot of us, you know, the idea of the flow of our week and how things go, you know, and basically all you have is Monday and you're living for Friday, right? You know, Friday is what we're looking for. We're looking to get to Friday. You know, if you look on social media, you know, if you're on Facebook or in different places, one of the things, and honestly, I don't spend a whole lot of time there, but if you spend time on social media and in different places on Monday, that is one of the roughest days when it comes to work. It is, because everyone's like, oh, the weekend's done, now I'm back here. Oh, how painful. And they post different things, and they post pictures and stuff like that. They post things, and maybe you're familiar with this term, most of you probably are, the idea of a meme. A meme, you know, you post a picture that that is kind of a summary statement with regard to something in our culture or our society. It's the idea that, you know, that this is something that our society or that people believe to be true or certainly to speak for their experience. And so on Mondays, work memes are all over the place. You know, you find different pictures and, you know, people putting quips and stuff like that. You know, we call the middle of the week what? Hump day, because what? We've made it this far. It's all downhill from here. You know, we call the work week overall, we call it the grind. Why? We go to work and we just get ground up. It just grinds us up. It just, you know, and it's tough. It's tough. Work is tough. And lest you think, well, survive that, I'm retired, right? Unless you think you know, hey, this doesn't apply to me or whatever. Wherever you are at, and whatever the things are that God allows to fill your week, that's your 9 to 5 in this series. That's your grind. That's your, you know, the way that God has your week flowing. And sometimes, even though it's not something you get a paycheck for necessarily, it can still be really hard. Some of you, and if you've retired, you know, it could be that you have, you know, grandkids and stuff like that. Let me tell you, taking care of grandkids, not from experience, but taking care of grandkids, that's work. The blessing and maybe the payment for that work is you get to give them back, right? You get to say, okay, see you next time, you know, kind of thing. And that's the way it worked. But this fits for you too. Here's a couple memes that I pulled off for you to see. All right? Look at that little guy. That's how I look when I leave work, knowing that I've done nothing all day, right? I survived another 8-9 hours of just sliding through, but I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything. How about this one? I don't remember what I actually do here, and at this point, I'm just too afraid to ask. Too afraid to ask. Let me share something with you. I used to have this recurring dream. Dreams are very interesting because they take a splash of reality and a little bit of imagination, and it mixes together while you're sleeping, and it either makes you feel wonderful or gives you the frights. You know, but I used to have this dream that somehow I was escaping going to school, and that I never really went to classes, and that there were these days that I did go back to school, but I couldn't remember what classes I was in, and I couldn't remember where my locker was. And so I didn't have the books. So I was going in and out of classes that I didn't know that I really, if I belonged there or not. And I had nothing to turn in. It was just miserable. But I was what? I was too afraid to ask. I was scared. That doesn't have anything to work. Well, at that point, going to school was my work. Here's another. Look at all of this work I haven't done yet. I haven't done yet. But I can sing over it. And, well, that just doesn't help it to get done. We're talking about our workplace, we're talking about our workspace, and we're talking about how God desires to use us in it. And so we're going to be unpacking that. This is 4 weeks we're going to be spending here. If you were to take the time to think through the average person's work life and to just say, well, I want to get all of the work for my life done and just be done with it. The average person, if you were to just back-to-back it, not take a break, not take a vacation, not take a weekend, whatever, and you just cut all that out, you know, clipped it, you know, and lined it all up together, people average that it's somewhere in the 9 to 10 years range that you would just work without ceasing and then be done. 9 to 10 years. I thought that was interesting. I was like, wow. Do we really work that much? Is there really that much time? Or some of you may be saying, that's it? That's it? Do you, that person doesn't work where I work, you know, kind of thing. But work, again, is not simply the job you go to. It is where God has placed you and how he has you using the beauty and the gift of the time that you have. So how do you handle these things as from the Lord, and how do you navigate them? And how do you magnify Christ at work? So we're gonna start this morning with that thought, and we're gonna be asking the question, is work, whatever that may be for you, is it a blessing or is it a burden? Is work a blessing or is it a burden? Which of the two is it for you? What's your motivation for working? And you know, why is it that I have to stay at the job? Or why do I even stay at the job that I have? Why do I drag myself out of bed in the morning to get there? Oh, I'm miserable with it. And so the issue of motivation and all of those things in the backdrop, those kinds of attitudes, you know, have a lot to do with determination for us. And we're going to be looking at that idea today with two bigger thoughts of is what I do a blessing or is it a burden? And so let me ask you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1, Genesis chapter 2. So we're going to start in the beginning, seminal passages. If you want to use a Bible that's available for you there in the chairs, you can do that. It's page 3 and 4 where we're going to start, and you can kind of follow along there. You can also use the message guide. The verses are going to be there also as we work our way through. But what I want to see today as we consider this idea of blessing or burden is first this biblical truth, and that is that God established work. God established work. That the idea of work, and work begins with him. He is the one who established work. It comes from him, and he himself is a worker. He's a worker. It's not something we decided to do. It's something that came from him. We didn't say, wow, you know, I got all this free time and I just don't know what to do with all this free time I have. Maybe I'll do something. And you know, just to kind of be fun, let's try to make it, you know, worthwhile or valuable. And we'll call it work. Work. It wasn't, if you would, our idea. God created it. It was his idea. And the beauty of what we see is, if you would, Scripture says, his handiwork. That what we see around us in the beauty of creation and those things are his work. So if we start in Genesis 1, which if you were to take the time, and if we were to take the time to read through it, we see that God, beginning in Genesis 1, speaks to the issue of creation. And as he speaks to the issue of creation, he speaks to the creation of the heavens and the earth. He speaks to the creation of light, of day, of night, of the sky and of the land and of the sea. He speaks to the creation of the vegetation and of the forests and the things that we see that fill this creation. It says that he created the sun and the moon and the stars. And then it says that he created all living creatures, those creatures that roam this incredible creation that he has made. And finally, it says that he created man, that he created you and me. And when he created that, if we want to tie it forward and we want to tie it into, and if we understand, let me back up a little bit. He created man, and in Genesis chapter 1, we'll see in a second, it says that he created man in his own image, that there's something unique about man that is not the same as the rest of his creation, that there is an image that is placed in us, a spirit, a spiritual life that is placed in us that is not the same as what we see around us. And so there is this physical creation in man is physical, it is spiritual, and you go into the New Testament and you see, and we've talked about this before and it ties into our thought for today, you see in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10 where it says, beginning in verse 8 actually, for by grace you've been saved through faith, this not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And then he says this, we are God's workmanship created in Christ to do good works, which he has planned for us. And so we put together God's creation and his work with the fact that he has created us and we are a unique creation, that by design, we also work and he has wonderful things for us to do. God established work. And so in Genesis, we see that. In Genesis 2, he goes on, and we are going to look at these verses. This is chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, and we're going to go down through verse 3. It says, thus the heavens and the earth and all of the host of them were finished. On the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it because in it he rested from all his work, which God had created and made. And so this is really Genesis 1 and 2, the first account of work, God creating and then him resting. And so we look at this and we say, well, isn't it nice? Because he also made the weekend. Because after he finished the work, he what? He rested. He rested. And so let me say, you need to work. You need to understand that God has work for us to do, but he also, in light of that work, has rest for us to have. But if you're not working, not so sure, you're probably doing too much of the other, doing too much of the resting. And so here he says, God has been busy at work. God has been busy at work. God established work. And not only did he establish that work and do that work then, but do we understand that God continues and is doing work now? That he's doing work now. That God continues to do work, and he does that by sustaining his creation. He meets the needs of his creation, of you and of me and of all that we see around us. We see that when we pray, he answers prayer. He works on behalf of this creation that he has made. He's working. He works through his purposes, and he works out his purposes in history. It's work. And we know that ultimately, even as we think of, we've just come out of Christmas and we begin to move towards Good Friday and Holy Week and Easter, we know that even Christ worked on the cross. Through tragedy, God brought glory to himself and salvation to you and me. He established work, and he does amazing things through work. He sets the example as far as work. God himself is in the work he created, and he does it. And so let me just say that God is not absent, having established it. He's not absent from Monday to Saturday. Sunday is not the only God day. It hasn't become that God rests every day now other than Sunday, and you know the rest of the week he's absent. God is at work all of the time. In your life and in my life, in our world. And so we see God sets the example for us with regard to work. Let me suggest, secondly, from this, that he expects us to work. That we draw from this that there's an expectation on our part that we would work also. He created us to do work too. It's not meant, however, for us to be clicking off boxes, or how many of you are list makers and clicking offerers or whatever you want to call it? You couldn't get through a day without your list. When I just came on staff at a church a number of years ago, everyone on staff there had taken a course called Priority Manager. And it was a way to organize your life, your work life, and stuff like that. So you didn't lose track of things. You knew when your meetings were. You knew when projects were due. And you talked about time activating things and clicking things off and checking them off and stuff like that. And that really played into me because I like lists. I like to keep things in order. I like to, you know, make sure that this is that and that's that and stuff like that. And so I liked keeping my priorities managed. And so he expects us to work, but clicking off the boxes is not per se what he's talking about here. It's not meant for us to just click off boxes and to do mundane things. There's a much bigger thing for us to do when it comes for us to work. When we work hard and we take care of responsibilities, there's a couple of things that happen. When we do what God expects us to do, some things happen. First, let's notice this. When I work, I fulfill my purpose. When I work, I fulfill my purpose. Over in Genesis 2 in verse 15, this is what it says. Then the Lord took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to what? To tend and to keep it. So when Adam and Eve are, so when the work is going on in the garden, that is accomplishing the purpose that God gave for man, to tend the garden, to take care of it. Adam and Eve were not in the garden just trying to figure out how to spend their time. It was like, Adam, what are we going to do? Well, I don't know. What do you want to do? I don't know. Let's go down by the stream again. Well, we did that yesterday. All right, well, then why don't we walk over and see the deer and the antelope and watch them play? But we just did that. We did that on whatever day. No, it was very clear that God had work for them to do, and he made it clear what that work was to be, and that was for them to be tending and to keeping the place that he had given them to live. They were to be working in the garden. He put them there to take care of it, to work. And so as we work in keeping with his purpose for us and where he leads us, where he places us. And he uses a couple words here in this passage to describe this work. And these are unique words in the sense that we can connect them with things that are in other areas of our life. And let me explain that a little bit. The first word that he uses here is the word avad. The word avad. Avad is a word that is very simply to work or to till. It's kind of that farmery kind of word. I work here, I till this, I'm preparing it. And then the second word that he uses here in different places is the word shamar, which is, again, a different word, but it's the idea to keep. So he says he wants them to tend, to till it, and to keep it, shamar. And in other places of scripture, you can connect some different ideas here. And one of the people that I was reading, one of the pastors I was reading, connected it this way, that for Adam and Eve, God wanted them to till and to tend the place that God had given them and to keep it. And he likened it this way. He said, God's call on every believer is this, that we would worship and that we would keep his commandments. That we would live a life of worship, and in so doing, we flesh that out by keeping his commandments. The idea is this, is that if you're gonna tend the soil, if you're gonna care for it, if you're gonna do weeding or whatever, you just don't weed to weed, you weed for a purpose. And so you want to plant something there, you want something to come of it, you wanna go somewhere with it. And so if I'm going to worship the Lord, the way that I'm going to worship the Lord, this pastor argued was that I'm going to worship by living my life in such a way that God would be honored, that God would be glorified. In fact, that Christ would be magnified. And that he would be magnified in whatever I was tilling or whatever I was caring for. So God expects us to work. He's given us work to do. And that work is to fulfill a purpose that he has for us. When I work, I fulfill my purpose, the purpose he has for me. And so we have a responsibility to care for the things that he has placed in our hands. Second, let me suggest this, that when I work, I reflect the image of God. Again, if God is a worker and we are made in his image, then the way I see it, there is some work for us to be doing. People will see him in us when we are good workers. Genesis 1:27 that I alluded to earlier says this, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. And so when we are doing what he wants us to do, we are reflecting, we are showing others his image. We want others to see that. Now, for some reason, and this may be because I kind of crossed over the lines a little bit between last week and this week, but it seems to me that I spoke a little bit to the idea of a trend, that's the way I'll put it, that kind of got big and it's kind of waned a little bit, you don't hear much about it, of shadowing or of like take your kid to work week or day, right? And, you know, the kids, you know, show up, you know, and are in tow with mom or dad or whatever, you know, and they sit there in a chair and they watch mom and dad click and clack on the keyboard and the stuff flies across the screen and stuff like that, you know, and the kids are just, you know, at least the young ones are just trying to figure out, how do I survive this? You know, how many, nine to five? You do this for that many hours? That's incredible. How is that possible? You know, but there is this idea of living out and seeing this image that is being born, and the shadowing happens. And so when we take our kid to work, there's a sense in which God has allowed Adam and Eve to see what he has done, and they have a hand in caring for what he has made. And people look and they see, wow, they are just like their mom or their dad. They're just, because they're doing that. And so not only do we fulfill our purpose, but we reflect the image, and God has placed in us this image of himself. And as a worker himself, we too follow in that same course. Let me suggest the third idea is that when I work, I experience God's increase. There's a blessing in that. Things happen when I do what God wants me to do. Things happen when I'm involved in the things that God has his hands in. Genesis 1, verse 28. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." He says, "I've given this to you, manage it. Manage it in such a way, work on it in such a way, take care of it, tend it in such a way that what? It will be fruitful and it will multiply so that good things happen." God didn't tell Adam and Eve to live in the garden, but don't mess with it. Don't touch anything. Just be here. He said, make something with it. Do something with it. It's the picture of the parable that Jesus tells later on of the master who entrusts to his servants and his workers a portion each. And he says to them, do something with this. Do something with this. What are you doing with what God has entrusted to you? What am I doing with what he's entrusted to me? You see, sometimes we're so scared, we just kind of, if you would, we hide it, or we hold on to it. You know, what if I mess it up? You can trust God that he will work with you, and that as you walk with him and seek to worship and be obedient, that there will be a blessing, and there will be fruitfulness, and there will be multiplication, and he will be glorified. I'm thinking about the fact that we're going to be coming to Tuesday evening prayer meetings without Nancy. Nancy was at prayer meeting, and I say this in the most appropriate sense, religiously. Nancy was at prayer meeting. And there are times where when people who come to prayer meeting would say, you know what, this evening I kind of felt like I didn't really want to come. But in reality, if Nancy could be here, I can be here. And we were talking the other day about in prayer meeting about the idea of just thinking forward and looking that one day we're going to be in the presence of Christ. And you know, in some measure, we may review or we may not review because we're going to be so taken up with the worship of our Savior that we're going to be thinking about all of the things that we did and all of the things that we didn't do and stuff like that. And we're going to be thinking about the prayers that we prayed, and we're going to be thinking about the people that we brought before Christ, and we're going to recognize that God worked in amazing ways in people's lives because we prayed. And then the thought came to mind, and we talked about this. How stupid, how weird, how awful will we feel that we did not pray more, knowing that God did these amazing things in response to just our little prayers. If only we had sought him more, if only we had asked him for more, if only we had said, God, we need your blessing in this place, or provide in this way, or whatever, would we be able to reflect back and see more of his goodness to us? And in this sense, in terms of work, let me say this, don't sell work short. Don't go for the least. Don't say, well, I've done my time. Because I believe the more we give ourselves to Christ in doing and seeking to fulfill his purposes in us, the greater the blessing will be on the other side when we reflect back and we see just how good God was and how the fruitfulness came and multiplication happened and God was magnified, Christ was magnified. So God expects us to work. We fulfill our purpose in it. We reflect the image of God in it. We experience an increase through it. When I work, also number four, I provide for my needs. When I work, provision happens. Unfortunately, like I said earlier, thinking of Be Thou My Vision, most of our focus is on this. Most of our focus is on the fact, if I work, then my needs will be met. We're not thinking so much of the blessing. We're not thinking so much of our faithfulness. We're not thinking so much of the idea of the reflection that we are in our faithful work of Christ. We're thinking more of, whew, I got money to pay the bills now. Whew, I can put a little in the bank now. I can plan for retirement now. Whew, looking forward to that vacation. I can do all of these things. Why? Because I worked. But when I work, it is true, I provide for my needs. I'm able to do those things. I don't know any of you. I've never met anybody who wants to work for free. Do you know anybody like that? If you do, I mean, you ought to sell tickets, because people would come to see that. Somebody would work for free. Now, some of us do serve, and we serve just out of the goodness of our heart, but working for free, like we're talking about, that's a whole different thing. Over in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 10, this is Paul, and he's writing, and he says this. He says, "For even when we were with you, we commanded you this, if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat." Working allows you, it opens the door for provision for your needs. And it's interesting, it's not for yourself only, not just for your family, but it also allows you to meet the needs of others. Paul wrote to the Ephesians, and he was speaking to them in Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4 is really the practical side of the first chapters of Ephesians, because God is saying, this is how Christ has worked, and this is how you are to walk. And so as he speaks to them about how they're to walk and how they're to live and accomplish their purpose, this is what he says. He says, "Let him who steals or stole steal no longer. Rather, let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may" what? "Have something to give him who has need." So what's he saying here? He's saying the person who was living a life on the dole, if you would, or on the five-finger discount, or just not working, but just stealing, let that person work. Let that person give themselves to what God has for them, his purposes, and to live out his image, and to be prosperous and profitable. And you know what? God will be fruitful and bring fruitfulness and multiply that work, so that that person's needs, not only that person's needs are met, but also so that they have enough that they can help meet the needs of somebody else. Because let's face it, there will be, and maybe there hasn't been, but we know people in whose lives there are times when they need help to meet the needs of. It's not their wants, it's their needs. And God says, when you're faithful in this, you will see my provision, and you will also be able to help others have their needs met too. So God gives us the example of work. He expects us to work. And then let's just close with this thought. There's an effect, or there's something that has happened to work because of sin. Because of the entrance of sin into the world, the work that Adam and Eve knew in the beginning was not necessarily the same as the work that they knew after the garden. And the work that you and I experience and that we work through, even though we've talked about it thus far, there is an effect, or that work has been affected, and there are some effects to our work and the way that we serve and we live out that purpose. We need to be mindful of that. And so there's this sense in which all that we've said thus far, you know, apart from us, and if we were to look at it from that Genesis 1-2 kind of way, we'd say, wow, you know, there's a lot of good things to be said for work. Because God showed us work, and he expects us to do it, and we accomplish our purpose, and he blesses us, and he provides for us, and we're the image of God when we do it, and it That's blessing. That's good. But we also see, because of sin, that we see there's another side to it. There's also a burden that comes with this work. And so today, when we ask the question, is work a blessing or is it a burden? The answer is not so simple. In fact, I'm going to put it this way. This is our transforming truth. Work is actually a blessing and a burden. It's actually both. We see work as both a blessing because of what God desires to do through it and because of the way that he has created it. But we also know that because of sin, work is a burden. It's not easy. We know by looking in the book of Genesis that the work that Adam and Eve were doing became much harder following the fall. It was not so easy for them to produce crops. It was not so easy for them to keep the garden. In fact, they were no longer in the garden because God put them out of the garden to separate them from the tree of life. So God's effect on work because of sin, and so let's think about this. Despite of the blessing that God intended, work becomes a lifelong reminder, and it becomes a lifelong frustration of the fact that things aren't the way that God originally intended. We see that over in Genesis chapter 3. It says this: Then to Adam he said, Because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree which I commanded you, saying, You shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it will bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. The boundary was for them to not eat of the tree of life, but they did it anyway. That beginning role that they had to work was to care for the land, and it was an incredible blessing. But the ground after the curse and after the fall was no longer as fertile and no longer as friendly and no longer as easy to take care of as it had been in the beginning. And so work at that point became a frustration, became a burden. The idea of pain, and he says here, and this has the idea of painful toil, the idea of prolonged or fatiguing labor. It's the idea of struggling or sorrowing. It's the sense that the work never ends. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the movie The Incredibles. It's kind of a Pixar, Disney-ish kind of thing about these people who have superhero strengths and they're marginalized because people don't like, you know, them and stuff like that. I don't want to tell you. But at the beginning of the movie, there are these interviews that are happening with these superheroes. And as they are interviewing the superheroes, you get a sense of how they view life and how they view their role. And one of these gentlemen, Mr. Incredible, is being interviewed, and he says this. He says, you know, I go and I fix something, or I save someone, or I do this incredible thing, and basically, this is my version of it. After it's all done, I sit down and I say, whew. But then all of a sudden, it's broke again, and someone else needs me, and something else is happening, and I've got to go out again. Let me be honest with you. Sometimes I feel like that Sunday afternoon or Monday morning. Made it through that Sunday, and then I wake up on Monday morning and I'm like, Sunday's coming again. What? When will I ever not face a Sunday? Let me say this: I love being with you guys on Sunday. But we have this sense and this frustration, if you would, that comes from, whereas it was a joy and the fulfilling that expectation was filled with blessing because we were so close to God and doing, Adam and Eve were so close to God and doing what he wanted and stuff. And now because of the fall, it's just hard. And we don't look forward to Monday morning or Tuesday. Maybe the only morning we look forward to is Friday because it's the last day of the week. So there's an effect from the fall on this blessing that God has given us. And the blessing is not only just a blessing, but now it's a burden. You ever notice that the stuff that you have to do, it's never-ending tunnel. It's like you see the light at the end, but you never can get to the end. It's the mom who's at home who finds that the laundry basket is never empty, that there's always one more meal, always one more meal to get ready or to feed the kids. Do you know what that feels like? It's hard. And so this burden mentality brings some problems to us. And there's a couple here let me just share really quickly with you. First, this toil and this pain, this work, brings continual discouragement. It's very easy for us to be discouraged in our work. Some of us, we don't like our jobs. We don't like where we're at right now. We're not happy with that. And so this job and this what I'm doing right now is toil. You wake up and you don't want to get out of bed. It's discouraging. It also brings the thought of defeat. For some of us, we think about it's just too hard. I can't ever seem to get over it. We're too tired to finish, and it's like we can never quite check off that box. There's always one more of these things to do. And you're sitting there and you're saying, you know what? I just need a nap. I just want to take a break. It's hard. Sometimes we look at, it's not fair. We don't like what's going on around us. Some of us look around our workplace and we see that, like that meme in the beginning, where it's like, you know, I've been here so long, I don't really remember what I'm supposed to do here, but I'm scared to ask. Some of us, we look around and we watch the other people and we say, I'm working like a dog. And Steve over there, he's not doing nothing. What's the matter with me? It becomes, and we feel defeated. There's always one more bag of trash to take out. Isn't that true? How does that happen? Maybe in your home you play top it off, drop it off. Do you play that? If you're the one who tops it off, so not another single anything, not even a napkin could lay on the top of it without it all going to pieces like Jenga. If you're the one who tops it off, you're the one who gets to drop it off. You play top it off, drop it off. There's always one more bag of trash. It's toil and it's hard. It brings fatigue. Fatigue, extreme fatigue. There we go. We're tired. And then let me just give you the last one here. It brings oftentimes resentment of my job and what was meant to be a blessing and this place that God has placed me to be a light and to shine his image and to make him larger. Just makes it a place that I resent, that I don't like. And it just hurts my relationships with those that I'm there to be a light for Christ with. And it just gets really, really tough. So what do we do? So let me give you two things to do when work becomes challenging, when it's more of a burden than it is a blessing. And the first is this, very quickly, is I want to encourage you to commune with God. Maybe you're a Christian and you're saying, my workplace stinks, or not a Christian, and you say, it's just really hard. I just don't know what to do with work. This is where God has me, but I'm just kind of miserable. I'm tired. I just don't know how to put it. I'm discouraged. I'm here and I feel like I do my part, but nobody else does their part, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe you know what I'm talking about there. Let me encourage you this morning to, in terms of connecting with God, to give your life to Christ. When we give our life to Christ, it begins to change our perspective with regard to things. And one of the things that begins to happen is that our perspective with regard to work changes. And we begin to see work less as a burden and more as a privilege, as a blessing that God has given us so that we can be like him and allow the light of Christ to shine into the lives of others. That our workplace becomes our mission field. I'm so glad that Penny and Rosie are going to Honduras. What an incredible blessing. What a great thing for our church that our people are beginning to see the need and the vision and to take advantage of the opportunities to go to other places and be a light for Christ. But let me encourage you with this. If you live here in Gardner or Ashburnham or Baldwinville or Templeton or Phillipston or Westminster or Winchendon or wherever it is that God has placed you, Fitchburg or Leominster, that's your mission field. Your workplace is your mission. That's your place. So work there. And do great things for Christ there. Commune with him. So if you don't know him, connect with him and allow that to begin to change your mind. If you do know him, let me encourage you to be reminded of how your relationship with Christ begins to change and transform your perspective. And then secondly, as you walk, let me encourage you to do this. Choose faithfulness in your work. When you're in the moment, it's hard. It's really hard. It's hard when you're in the moment and it's just not going the way you thought. But in that moment, choose to honor him. Say, God, help me to choose in the midst of what's going on to please you. Because ultimately, he is your boss, not your boss. Always seek to honor the boss with the capital B, not necessarily the boss with the small. And let me tell you what, if you honor the boss with the big B and you live for Christ in your workspace, your workplace, if honoring Christ is first in your life, then you will be honoring your earthly boss. You will be. It may not seem like it. It may seem like you're making decisions that, but honoring Christ always is the greatest honor to the boss that's around you. Let me close with this. Mark Twain, also known as Samuel Clemens, he had this to say with regard to work and getting stuff done. Mark Twain said, "If your job is to eat a frog, it's best to do it first thing in the morning. And if your job is to eat two frogs, it's best to eat the biggest frog first." I don't know what your life looks like this week, but I just want you to know that there is incredible blessing in serving Christ at work. But it also comes with some burdens, because our world and things are just not the way that God intended for them to be. And so if you're going into work today, tomorrow, Wednesday, whenever, and maybe it's even not work, it's what God has for your life. Let me encourage you to honor him. Let me encourage you to put his purpose for your life in the forefront. And allow others to see the image of Christ shine through you. May it be in your place that he is being magnified. Father, thank you for this moment. And Lord, we pray and we ask that you would help us. And God, we're talking about work these couple weeks, but we're going to be talking about our church. We're going to be talking about our families. We're going to be talking about serving and the gifting that you've provided for us. And so we're going to take this in a number of different ways, Lord, over these next weeks and months. But God, I pray and I ask today that for this mission place, this place of serving that you have put us, that God, you would help us to know and that you would help us to be lights for Christ and to magnify him, that we would see our work as an incredible blessing. Thank you for providing. And Lord, at the same time, that you would help us. Help us to recognize that you are with us in the midst of the burden. Heavenly Father, we pray and we ask that we would serve you well. Lord, not only 9 to 5, but each and every moment. In his name, amen.
Our last song is going to be Facing a Task Unfinished. Please stand. Thank you.
It's a wonderful song to close our service today, because God is sending us out into the world. For some, like Rosie and Penny, he's sending them out to Honduras. But for those of us who remain here in Gardner, wherever you're from, he's sending us out into our workplace, our work space, wherever it may be. And may it be that as we go out into the world with our kingdom flag, the flag of Christ unfurled, may people see Christ in us. May we be a light for him. What an incredible thought that we are allowed to be that, and he calls us to do that on his behalf. A lot going on. Let me encourage you, remind you about moving the furniture, if you would. Let me also remind you about the cafe that's available for you. We invite you to stay. Enjoy a moment of fellowship. If you'd like to stay for one of the Next Step groups, they'll start 10-15 minutes from now, and so we encourage you to continue your growth in Christ. Our benediction this morning, taken from the book of Ephesians, chapter 3, Paul again writing, he says this, "Now him, to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we could ask or think, according to the power, his power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forever and ever. Amen." God bless you as you go.